Today, it's Edwin's Monday evening property rant. Hello again, it's Martin North from Digital Finance Analytics. Welcome to this post covering finance and property news with a distinctively Australian flavour. Monday evening, Edwin is with me. And Edwin, what on earth are you doing?
I'm saving energy, Martin. I'm saving electricity.
Just don't burn your fingers or set the house on fire.
Well, the only thing is these bloody redheads aren't as good as what they used to be.
No, I know. Everything's gone cheap, isn't it?
Look, we've got to warm ourselves up. You know, even Evan's next to me. We got to stay warm. There's electricity, energy, shortages, and they tell me that John Adams went down and burnt the powerhouse, something the generator down there, something like that.
We had a big fire down south of Wollongong. Luckily, it didn't impact the local power supply up here, but it was a little scary to think. Well, okay, something else fallen over. Get less energy around, but we're still here. Of course, it's difficult to make a show without any energy, right? I mean, I get the dogs running on the treadmill to try and generate a bit, but you know, they keep running.
Well, I just need to get some mice.
yeah, that's probably right. Actually, put mice in front of them, they might go a bit faster. Good idea.
Yeah, look, that's it. But look, it's madness out there, and it's only getting worse. So we joke about it, we jest about these things, but you know, in all seriousness, it's really getting bad out there. And from our chats with the legal fraternity and our legal eagles out there, there's more crime is on the rise. A lot more little brothers and little sisters are getting caught up with hydroponics, and because of the work situations, are just given the only thing they could basically do at the moment in most cases for them is looking after the hydroponics and this is in Sydney, in the Sydney metro area, in homes, and then they get busted. It's a madhouse out there. The poor Kryptonians are getting smashed, Martin. You know, what's going on? Are we going to see Bitcoin Mark II coming up later on? Is crypto dead? Is Bitcoin dead? Or are we going to get a new form of blockchain coming up in the near future?
Well, it's all very interesting. I did a show yesterday on the cryptos, and Bitcoin dropped below 20,000. It's come back a little bit now, and I suggested that this might be different this time. And of course, all the supporters of Bitcoin said, no, it'll bounce back, it's fine. You know, it's not the same as all the other altcoins, they're the problem. Bitcoin's going to be sailing through, but I have to tell you that looking at the exchanges today, there are a lot more people moving there. Bitcoins back into the exchanges with an attempt to try and sell them. So I'm not sure. We'll just wait and see. It just shows you that when you take liquidity out of the system, and of course that's what's really been happening in a little while, it's everything. You know, if you stop giving people money, the government stops giving handouts, they don't have so much money to buy crypto or anything else.
Well, we spoke about Muskonomics, and that was what our WeChat chatters brought up a few weeks back. If you recall.
I do. Yeah, it seems to be true. Seems to be right.
They were on the money, Martin. They were on the money.
Yeah.
And it's just one of those, one of those things that they warned us. They said there was something like 23,000. They saw 23,000 Bitcoins move, or being transacted in portions of up to about 100 at a time, and they didn't know whether they went back to Musk himself or was a part of Tesla. They were trying to work that out, but that was the signs that people were the trust in Bitcoin or those coins was sort of losing its edge, and here we are. But look, we've been speaking about a lot of these things. Ahead of the mainstream, ahead of what a lot of people would, have woken up to over the weekend and found out that they're in a lot of strife. Now we're also going to be talking about, being ahead of times. We're going to be talking about the new love affair between China and Australia. That's coming along in ways that you and I have been speaking about. What may happen regardless of which power took control or which government took control post the election, and how that's going to impact the property market, potential impact the property market. Obviously, energy supply chain issues and the preference that people are going to have with regards to the choices that they're going to make moving forward. We've got the state now going hand in glove with the federal government with government subsidies or schemes to help people buy homes. We're going to share that as well. So there's a lot of chatter, a lot of turbulence, a lot of ups and downs. The market hasn't found any form of stability, I don't think. And we've also seen a lot of out of line sales. You know, some are very high and some are very low. And we're going to sort of chat about that a little bit more in more detail with what some of the people have been tweeting out and talking about as well. But yeah, look, everything's in a bit of a quandary and not knowing which way it's going to turn. And it's really, it's almost like we've got to go week by week as opposed to what we used to do our analysis on a quarterly basis. Now it's just governments, world governments, and local affairs are just turning on a dime every week.
Yeah, it is moving very quickly and changing direction and trajectory, and a lot of externalities all coming over the top. So it does make life very interesting, but never mind, we can give it a go. I guess a good place to start, Edwin, is this China and Australia relationship thing, right? Is it coming back?
Look, we've been speaking with some of our WeChat chatterers over in China, and these are retired analysts and people in the property industry, in high ranking positions in the property industry, and what they're sharing with us is what the mainstream is sharing with the local people, which is rather interesting, because as I said, I call it the new love affair between the current government and China, and basically they're putting it along these lines. They're saying the iceberg that has come between China and Australia over the past 2 years is slowly melting away. Oh, how cozy is that? And so they're talking Australia up again, basically talking, in a way, talking down what happened over the last 2 years with the ScoMo government, and now that the new government's in power, they're really talking it up, and it seems like there's a new love affair. But then again, Martin, they've got a major issue there with unemployment, particularly with the if you recall, the over 10 million university graduates, and they can't get a job. So they're basically, what these analysts are telling us is that China is looking at a way to, call it outsource or call it export their unemployment issues. So they're looking at us as, they're talking about Australia as being a safe destination to further your education, career, and also a safe travel haven for those that are looking at getting to know the rest of the world. So as opposed to the language that was being talked about when the Liberal government was in power.
Of course, on the other hand, you could say that Australia hasn't got enough workers. Unemployment is very, very low, and all the businesses are saying we can't find people at the right price point, at least. So maybe there is a mutually beneficial opportunity for the moment, but we'll see where that plays out. But it is interesting. Did you see that China was talking about consolidating their purchases of iron ore? So what they're going to try and do is to actually orchestrate it so that you get effectively one entity up in China driving all of the iron ore purchases to drive the price down. So that's another little alternative story in terms of actually what China is doing. So it's not all a bit of roses.
No, look, it's not. It's then again, look, if we think that we're going, that we're caught up in a whirlwind or a mixing machine, with the chops and changes that our previous government, our current government, and our state governments are throwing at us on a weekly basis. I mean, China's no different. If anything, we've also got to understand that there's not only the standard policy changes and government speak, forked tongue and so forth, but also you also got to understand that At the moment, there is a faction, in-house faction fight between two opposing powers within the CCP. So there's a lot going to be said. A lot of things are going to, one is pulling one way, the other one's pulling a different way. So we really won't know where everything is going to land until we get to the end of the year. What these analysts are telling us, retired analysts are telling us, is that the nature of the language, it's something that they that they do see that there will be a push in the near future, and maybe sooner than a lot of people expect, for China to really, they've got to do something about their unemployment rate as well. And as I said, mainly individuals with higher education, and they are also a pain, a thorn in the side of the central government, because these individuals are very affluent, very apt with communicating through social media, through using IT and so forth. So they pose a big threat. Best way to deal with it is to basically export them out. So who knows, Mark? Who knows what's to come? Even the state government is turning on a dime here as well with their housing policy. So who's to say the federal government don't open up the doors anyway? They've got to stop this. They've got to stop this. The carnage that's about to hit the property sector. They've got to stop it. They've got to cushion it. Well, what alternative? I mean, Albo and his cabinet, I mean, they're sitting on some pretty real estate at the moment. I think he sits on four properties, of one is worth over $3 million, from my understanding.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, it is going to be very interesting, and there is certainly some downward trends in terms of the property market, which we'll probably come on to shortly. I think with regard to China, it's always a lot more complicated than many people and many media mainstream writers sort of get, right? There's a lot going on, a lot of currents here and there and the other, but I think it's important just to reflect also that they've had to do further COVID lockdowns. And interestingly, I was reading something the other day suggesting that people in China are now saying they'll still be locking down into next year. So this is not going to cure itself anytime soon.
No, this is, look, one faction's very critical of the lockdowns. What's happening there, from my understanding, what I've been told, is that a lot of the second-tier cities and the regional governing bodies are taking it upon themselves to lock their people down. And it's really no longer about science. At what point, what was it about science anyway? Well, one would argue it's about controlling the masses and controlling the people. How do you control people that are going hungry? How do you control people that are going hungry and are in a rage, and they've got to feed their families? This is also in a way playing out in the States, with what they're going through with their shortages of fuel, or fuel and food and essential goods, and we're walking into shortages of essential services, such as your power outages, proposed power. I mean, it basically fuels the individual's anger, frustration. So this is what they've got to deal with. The alternative is either come up with a new pandemic, come up with a new way of locking people down in order to try and bring some sort of control and stability. I mean, what other choice do they have? There's 1.4 billion people in that country, and I don't know what the percentages are in terms of police or compared to the general population. But sooner than later, there's got to be, there'll be a civil war if they're not careful. But again, I say a lot of what's happening in the lockdowns that you're probably reading about are the, you could say, local governing groups that are trying to lock down that particular communities more than mandated by from the central government departments.
Absolutely, yeah. Well, bit of control, a bit of trying to keep a lid on a few things. I'm sure that's all part of it. But talking about lids on things, home dinner parties for local chatterers, eh? That's the next part of the story.
Yeah, well, that's just forever growing. We're about to book in a couple of dinner parties. Not that we're going to have. We're going to try to attend a couple of dinner parties. It's caught my attention. There's not much more being talked about other than what we shared last week with these dinner parties and what people. Yeah, people are looking at finding, and the local chatterers are looking at finding ways to basically save money, save on costs, as we've spoken about how they're using WeChat as the new REA and domain type of platform to sell property and to sell land. Also rentals through WeChat are a big thing, because a lot of the times they're renting also rooms. It's room lettings, as well as a room let with food. Like you could say, it's almost like bed and breakfast. Except they go, it's not a daily event; it's a weekly event. In order to cut on costs. So there's a lot of cost saving that they're talking about, a lot of ways to basically bring the businesses that they would otherwise have had in the local shopping malls or the strip shops and so forth, in the outer suburbs or along the old shopping areas. So obviously they're closing down, and they're looking for ways, many different ways, in order to basically make an extra income up. And that's just, and I think it's only going to increase by the greater need as our cost of living increase due to inflation, shrinkflation, and everything else. You only have to see it at the local shops ourselves, and also at the grocery stores where, in the restaurants. I mean, I don't dare go to restaurants anymore, because the meals are smaller, the food tastes like it was from the previous patron that came along, and it was just leftovers. It's rubbish. It's getting worse. It's not getting better. So they're just looking for novel ways to make money.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, there are shortages left, right, and centre. From lettuces through to all sort of things. In fact, I had a minor technical crisis. I needed to get some more plugs that I use in the studio here, and discovered that since I bought them last time, they're now 100% more expensive. So we'll be buying less plugs we might have otherwise. But you need plugs to be able to make things work. But talking about things that are shortages. Did you know that there's a shortage of real estate for sale signs?
Okay, I think it's the demand for the call flute signs and the big signboards are very high at the moment, particularly around strata complexes. It's insane. You just see more and more popping up like mushrooms all over the place. But I think we're going to see a lot more in what I call your second tier destinations for a lot of these overstaying migrants or ghost visa migrants, as we call them, and the areas that are going to be hard hit. So I shared this one on Twitter last week, and so far this particular tweet's had almost 10,000 views. It's just on the outskirts of Parramatta. And I think I counted something like 11 signboards outside two medium density apartment blocks. When I say medium, the one's probably had about 35, and the other one had about 45 units in total that weren't the high rise. So it's interesting how they're coming out more and more, and we're going to see more of this, as I said, in your second tier destinations, such as your let's say your Fairfields, your Liverpools, Kempsey to an extent. We're also going to see them around Liverpool, and obviously around Harris Park, where this is, and Parramatta as well. because you know, these are destinations for you know, for your immigrants that came on you know, either on student visas or short-term visas, and they overstayed because it cheap accommodation. And now that you find that a lot of them are vacant, the owners have to pay the strata levies. They have to pay the into the sinking fund. They're short. They're not getting the rents that they would otherwise have covered mortgages, because they also, you know, in these two bedroom apartments, they would have, you know, four, five, if not six adults living in the one apartment. So because of the fact that a lot of these people went back home during the pandemic, during the lockdowns, now we don't have them. And these are the people that make up our, low income or low paying job workforce that are in high demand at the moment, as because you can't get trades before we could get chip rockers when we were doing the house in the studio, when we were we tore most of the chip rock down and we rebuilt it to deal with some of the issues. I mean, we were hiring them at $350 a day. Now they're upwards of $450 to $500 a day. These are just chip rockers, and that's not including materials. I mean, these are insane prices when it comes to renovations and when it comes to building. Like you said, your plug, there was a rise and increase of cost of 100%. Labor's even for some trades is almost the same, because there's a shortages of manpower and there's a shortages of material. So it's creating a lot of issues. So a lot of these apartments in a lot of these areas, you're going to see a lot of for sales in a lot of the blocks, like the video that I've shown you, because the tenants that would otherwise occupy them to. And more so now because of the rate rises, so the investors can't meet the interest rate payments by the rent and the extra rent that they were getting. Their option is to put on the market, because they're also falling behind on the strata levies and other costs.
Absolutely. Well, it's interesting because, you know, I can remember you some time ago talking about the bus loads of of people going down to Parramatta and, you know, buying these high-rise apartments off the plan in their shed loads, right? The world's changed now, hasn't it?
Well, it's insane. And we were talking back then, years ago, it wasn't uncommon to see one or two bus loads come up, especially around the new construction around Hassel Street, down Church. Some off the plan, at the back of a lot of it was in Parramatta, because my office was in Parramatta at the time, and you could just see them bus loads upon bus loads, and it was the tour guides, and it was interesting because a number of people weren't just buying one, they were buying two. The mainstream media were putting out articles how entire business blocks got sold off the plan. Within one weekend. There's a couple of cases in Blacktown, which is another area that's going to get hit really hard. The Blacktown Centre, where there's a lot of development that happened there over the last few years as well. And there was an article there where a high-rise development got sold in a weekend, and the mainstream media made a big song and dance about it. Now what we're going to see is what we are seeing is a lot of these apartments that got bought off the plan in 2015, 2017, now coming back on the market for less than what they paid for back then.
Absolutely. Well, I'm seeing that in my surveys too. And interesting, down here in the Wollongong area, we're also seeing more for sale signs, particularly attached to some of those recently developed areas, which were sort of sold and then, yeah, people can't make them work. And economically, it's really interesting when you look at the details of some of these property investors, right, who are now paying more than they were for their mortgage. The strata fees have gone through the roof. The rentals are not rising because they can't find anybody to take the property, right, at what they want. And I know that people keep saying, well, you know, the vacancy rates are very low, but actually they're still having difficulty just finding people to meet the rents that they want to get. So, yeah, it's going to be very interesting. I think this is going to play out not just in the short term, but in the medium term, because it looks to me as though more and more. And by the way, even houses now in some of the suburban areas out and about around Wollongong, we're now seeing more for sale signs going up there as well. So, you know, like I said, shortage of for sale signs.
Yeah, look, it will be interesting to see how all this plays out. And more interesting for me in the space of apartments is going to be, you know, what are the owners' corporations going to do when there's a whole, you know, heap of for sale signs, and to an extent for lease signs as well, and they're all plastered in the common area. It's not a pretty sight, and it just brings the value of the property down, because obviously visually you see that there's, you know, there's a lot more for sale than what one would hope. And if you're an owner occupier, you're really gonna suffer. You're really gonna see a lot of carnage there, and you're gonna experience a lot of pain for the next year or two at least, or until, as you and I say, until the borders are opened up, and until we start seeing a lot more of these ghost migrants come into Australia and overstay, and depending on what the state government and the federal government do moving forward with the joint venture schemes and grants and every other thing that try to throw at the falling market.
Mm. And it's interesting. Did you see that Queensland is basically going to focus on getting vacant properties back into the market? I thought it was quite interesting. You and I have been speaking previously about the large numbers of properties that just held idle. Well, Queensland looks to be going to tackle that and try and get them back into the market again, either for rent or for sale, because they recognise that all of this vacant property is just not helping.
Well, when you say vacant properties, and when they talk about vacant properties, I can see Queensland pushing a little bit harder because of a lot of the subdivisions that they've got there in terms of housing. Whereas we would trump Queensland in terms of the high-rise developments that we've got. So right here in New South Wales or in Sydney, there's not a real appetite for young people, families to buy into these high-rise developments in this unit block in Parramatta. There's 12 units for sale, as I sent to you earlier today, Martin, when you did the research. And a lot of the properties that are for sale in that, you know, out of the 12, the majority of them are asking prices below the 2015 off the plan purchase price. Yeah. So, you know, and this is what's playing out. Queensland, I could imagine that I haven't read that article and haven't been up to date with what happens there, what's happening there in Queensland, but there's a lot more homes vacant that have been bought by overseas investors. And to me, it's just deja vu of the 90s when the Japanese went in there and bought in droves, and everybody thought they lost World War II, but they were going to take over in the 90s because of all the properties that they were buying left, right and centre. It just seems to be a bit of a deja vu, except from a different part of Asia.
Well, talking about deja vu, you may remember that during the election campaign, Labor came out with their 40% equity share scheme, right? And, you know, Labor was touting this as the best thing since sliced bread to help the property market. And, of course, ScoMo was very, very, very anti this and said, no, it's going to actually, you know, kill the market, et cetera, et cetera. And I remember there was a very famous picture of ScoMo saying this with Don Perriott, you know, just behind him, right? Our friendly New South Wales Premier. And guess what? They've just rolled out precisely the same scheme as the one that Labor had earlier tabled, right? So it's really funny. I wonder what he was thinking when he heard ScoMo saying, this is rubbish, we can't allow this, when they must have been plotting that particular scheme even then.
Yeah, look, it is rather interesting. But look, that's when ScoMo lost it. He lost the election. He obviously hasn't attended many auctions around the Southern Shire. He should have known better when Albo said we're going to do that joint venture scheme, a shared equity scheme, we're going to go to 40%. You know, Scammer should have jumped in and said, look, listen, buddy, you can
we'll go
40,
50.
50.
Exactly right, yeah. Well, we made that point, didn't we, at the time, I remember.
We did.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
What goes around comes around, right? That's hilarious.
We made that point.
Yeah.
And since you know, we're going to be talking about this the article with regards to the New South Wales government announcing the $780 million shared equity scheme to so-called address housing affordability. I did a little bit digging around, Martin, and look, I dare say, you know. Our premier, I'm 100% convinced that he watches our Monday night rant. And I do tag him from time to time. And I'll tell you what, you go to his profile, he follows you, Tarek, Lindsay David, myself, and you know, and a couple others there on that are regular on the show. So it's really really interesting. So look, good on him. You know, he thinks he could. Maybe he thinks this is a way for the Liberal Party to stay in power because the Labor gained power federally. I don't know, but once you start breaking this up, it's not what it seems. And you and I can, I guess, can. As we talk a little bit more, we can see why. I mean, we can talk figures. If the government talks figures of 40% for new dwellings and talks figures of 30% for established dwellings, right, on a $950,000 purchase. But let's talk real numbers. The government is saying that they're going to come in and going to, first of all, is it a loan? Is it a grant? All that has to be determined. But the 40% represents $380,000 per property, of which they're looking at subsidising 3,000 purchases in New South Wales over the next couple of years, or under this scheme, buying under this scheme 3,000. Or it also represents $285,000 if it's established home at 30%. That's the first thing that should open people's eyes. And you know, it's easy to say, oh, you're 40%, 30%, 50%, whatever, 20% of this, 10% of that. But when you start putting the real numbers in front, I want to know, is this a loan, separate loan from the government? Is it a deposit that the government's going to pay the bank along with the individual's 2%? And is the government going to charge the borrower a percentage, and what that percentage is going to be?
Well, there's no detail, right? And all these shared equity schemes have their catches. So the federal one had a thing where if your income started to go up, then you might have to actually purchase more of the property, right? Which is one of the little catches. And in the UK, there were various issues that came out. For example, the banks were less willing to actually fund these types of loans because effectively the risk profile is different, so they charge more. And so the borrower ended up with a bigger interest rate on their mortgage. So I wonder whether they will control the interest rate. And then what happens when the value goes up or go down? Is it split equally, right? Or does one half take priority over that other half? I mean, there are a bunch of questions. And of course, the other point to make is it's not a huge number, and it's being targeted specifically at particular types of workers, like teachers and police people. So in a way, it's a bit more of a sort of a political splash than it is necessarily a massive upheaval of the property market. But again, I have to remind everybody, these programs tend to have one outcome, and that is they lift the price of property.
Yeah, right? You look at the $950,000 target that they've adopted, right?
Mm.
The $950,000 target that they've adopted is, comes within the belt of, let's say, anywhere from you know, the Blacktown LGA right up to Penrith. And it also captures part of the Mid Mountains. Other than that, I guess in the southwest region, you'd have to go closer to Campbelltown in those areas in order to, for you to move into. And I'm talking about purely homes, right? Because apartments are a different kettle of fish. And this is another thing. We've got to differentiate. Is it the government's definition of a home? Is it a home as in you know, freestanding Torrens title dwelling, or is it an englober? Does it incorporate stratum, medium density, low density, medium density, and high density? What is it? That has to be, I guess that would have to be defined. Or is it just a broad definition, which means you could buy whatever you want. If people want to stay closer to the city and closer to the commercial hubs, where I would think that a lot of people would want to stay, well, they've got no option but to go into an apartment. And right now, between now and the way things are going to be playing out over the next 6 to 12 months, apartments could potentially drop in value another 20-30%. In a lot of these areas,
yep.
Right? And they're dropping in value not only because of the oversupply, and we've seen the numbers just rise and rise and rise in supply, supply and demand, but also the dropping in value because of the bad quality of construction. Hence the reason why there's been a lot of pressure on freestanding homes, to the fringes of Sydney. You're looking at your Penriths, you're looking at your St. Clair's, Claremont, you're looking at these areas around Kingswood. You're paying some of these homes there. They're asking anywhere between $950 to $1.2 million, Martin. In these fringes, that's what's happened because of the appetite to live in a freestanding home with a bit of land, as opposed to your new subdivisions in your Schofields and the newer parts of Quakers Hill and those areas, your Box Hills, your ponds, where the land envelopes go down as low as in your Jordan Springs, where the land envelopes go down as low as 280 square meters, mm-hmm. which is really, back in the day, it's just a block of land for what used to be part of a medium density development. It was a townhouse block of land, but they're freestanding homes, and it's incredible. So going back to that price point and what I can see, and we shared before the election, and I shared this point before the election, and that was, all this is going to do is going to put a further strain on first-time buyers that don't meet the government's criteria of that they sit above the government's criteria of, in other words, they're making more than $90,000 for an individual, more than $120,000 for a couple. They've got more than 2% as a deposit. So all that means to me is in that belt or that, yeah, that belt, that those regions where you would get these people that would come in and otherwise, comfortably pay and move in, they're going to make these homes less affordable once again. Yeah. Because what you could buy there for $900,000 or $950,000, you're going to be paying upwards of a million or $1,050,000. So the potential is that you're going to have a civil war between government-assisted first-home buyers and those that aren't government-assisted. They're just going to go toe-to-toe at the auction. One's not going to really care two hoots because at the end of the day, they're only coming in with 2%. They know their buffer is 950. So if the other party wants to get it for something that they either party would have got perhaps even under the 900, they're going to be paying 950 or a bit above. Who knows how much more than that the relatives and friends and mum and dad are going to tip in so that can be able to get the 950. So this creates a different level, creates another conundrum in itself, other than the obvious, in my opinion, is really the state government's and the federal government's way of trying to save the construction industry and basically push people into the new subdivisions where you've got your, because they're going to get the 40% as opposed to the 30%, and where you've got less land, you've got new construction, or high density towers close to commercial areas, because they're going to be feeling a lot of pain over the next 6 to 12 months.
No, you know, I agree.
That's just part of it. You know, the argument keeps on going as to what could happen.
And every time there's an incentive, it just push prices up, and that's clear. I guess the other point is, the deal will be sold. Well, you can get in and then you can ride the value of the property up, which means that your share expands, and then later you can buy the other share, right? So there is an economic thing that pays back to the government ultimately if prices go up. But the reverse is also true. If prices go down, the taxpayer's on the hook, right? The taxpayer's on the hook for the difference. And so actually, hang on, we could be actually seeing prices fall, and therefore the value of the share that's held by, New South Wales or whoever, goes down in value, which means, of course, it's on the taxpayer.
Yeah, and then I guess what we would need to do is talk to a property lawyer or a QC that specialises in property law and in this sort of joint venture schemes, because if let's say you're the bank, sorry, you're the government, and I'm the individual buying the property, although the property is in my name, but yet you own 40%, let's go 30%, because we bought and we're a little bit smarter, we bought an established home as opposed to a new one, because we've got more land, and I went bust, I lost my job, I went bust and everything else. So the bank, can chase me and whistle Dixie, because I'll pay them $5, $5 every month for the rest of my life. But you're the government, you can't do that. You still got to cough up your money, or potentially can the bank chase you as the government for the whole loan?
That's right. Is it joint and several, right?
Yeah.
That's the key question. Is it joint and several, or is it somehow segmented? And then if it is segmented, the government's got half of a property, the other half has now got no owner, so maybe the bank, how do they sell it?
So if it's segmented, Mike, if it's segmented, then one would think that the government's coming in with $780 million to from the taxpayers' coffers, right? So therefore, if that's the case, that the government's going to act as a bank, therefore they're entitled to interest on that 40%, right? Yep. Or the 30%, right? Which means you and I as a taxpayer are also entitled to be beneficiaries of that interest. So my question to Dom and Albo is, am I going to have a reduction in taxes? And from the state level and also from a federal level,
nice
because I want to benefit. If you're going to make money out of my taxes, I want to be partaker of the benefits, don't you?
Oh, it makes a lot of sense, but that's not how it seems to work, is it? Unfortunately, it seems to be a one-way gradient here. So, look, there's bunches of questions, and once we get more information about precisely the way the scheme is meant to be architected, we'll come back and have another detailed conversation, because I think there's a lot more here. And I have to tell you that research from the UK shows that this shared equity scheme that they ran didn't go very well over 5 years. A lot of people ended up with a lower property value than they thought. They couldn't then move. The costs involved were higher. And in fact, it also distorted the market too. So there's a bunch of, so what questions here. as with all of this stuff, makes a good political headline, but I'm not sure necessarily that the reality is actually, well painted out. And of course, the spin will be we're helping home buyers. The truth is, as you say, we're helping the developers.
Yeah, look, and to me, when I read the ABC article, right, and as to what our premier is quoted saying in there, it was alarming. It really was alarming to me, and where it says that, Premier Dominic Perrottet said New South Wales scheme would run as a 2-year trial and work hand in glove with the federal government's program. I think that's code for, we're going to tax you a lot more so we can make up for all this. Then this was the alarming point, and that was, we want to make sure that people right across New South Wales have that opportunity, because we know home ownership is crucial to growing wealth, he said. Since when, in what world or what dimension was a principal place of residence critical to growing wealth? If that's first, if that is, front of mind to our premier, you've lost me. You really sincerely lost me. And this scheme has got a hope in hell, of being successful. Look, it's going to be successful in uptake, but it's going to be very, very unsuccessful in the carnage that it's going to leave behind. Because, I would have thought that, security and longevity, or security of a household, of longevity, was going to be more front of mind than being crucial to growing wealth. I don't know, Martin. I don't know what you think, but I think this is, people have got the wrong priorities. Affordable housing, to me, is not is, it cannot be looked through the eyeglass of growing wealth. Affordable housing, to me, is security of a roof over your head, and security in terms of security and longevity of instability.
Well, there you have it. You see, that's exactly the problem. So we've switched property into the financialization of property. So property is now seen as a wealth-generating engine primarily, rather than, as you say, somewhere to live, shelter, security, all of those things, right? That's the problem. So, the conservative side of politics in particular, but not only, I think you'll find most Labour politicians also have that same view. That's where it's wrong, right? Because property is not about wealth generation. It is distorted. It's been distorted the last 30 years because of deregulation, ultra low interest rates, and all of these neoliberal strategies. But it's wrong. It's fundamentally wrong. And I have the view that we should think of property much more as shelter, somewhere to live, and actually making money out of it is not, it should not be part of the story. But there you go, that's an exception that proves the rule at the moment. Most people wouldn't buy that argument, but that's what I think.
No, and again, but then again, like you and I keep on saying, and somebody put out a meme, or put out a, I think it was the members in Albo's cabinet, that hold the most investment properties. Most of them do. I think all of them do, including Albert. And one of them has, on average, I think, across the board, they all hold anywhere between three and four properties. Some of them six or seven.
Yep.
I mean, so, and this is how the politicians see it. They don't see it any way different than the Doc and other spruikers that are out there in the mainstream.
No, I agree. Well, let's go on and talk about offline sales now, because this is another really interesting phenomenon, right? So whilst property prices might be sliding down in some places, and people are saying, oh, a bit of a correction, we're still seeing some places go through the roof.
Yeah, we are. But again, we've got to look at, we've got to be really, really careful as to and analyze what the background is. You and I said that, look, at the end of that, in this marketplace, people will pay over the odds, and we're seeing it, that people are paying 5, 10% over the odds with regards to homes that are new, that have been superbly finished, they've been renovated magnificently, and people want that, again, want that security, want that that knowing that they're going to buy it, they're going to just bring in their furniture and then close the door behind them to the, you know, and forget about the rest of the world, because they're going to be safe, secure, warm, and everything else, because it offers that. We're going to have those sales regardless whether the market's going up or whether it's going down. We're going to have people that are going to make that emotional decision and pay 5-10% over the odds with that. But when you start seeing that you know, these out-of-line sales that people start spruiking, and you see that video that I sent you, Martin, you know, in places that, you know, like in Roseville, and you start getting agents that are quoting guides of 1.8, and we have the receipts. As much as the agents try to get rid of those guides that they publish, we have the receipts. And they start quoting in areas where the median is anywhere between 2.8 and 3.4 million. And yeah, where the block of land on its own, regardless of the position, that block of land, you know, over 800 square meters, on as a block of land was worth 1.6 every day of the week anyway, let alone with a dwelling that he had and the work that could have been done to it to bring it up to speed. Now, you know, and you see these spruiking commentators talking about how wonderful the market is. And there was a Nine News show in Victoria how you know, it was hit and miss, but there was a lot more hits in the property market there, and they talked about how wonderful the wonderful prices that some homes fetched over the weekend, regardless of the, you know, how things were cooling, blah blah blah. And then we see this one, and we start looking at the, you know, at in detail. You know, we look at the location, we look at the area, we look at the median, we look at the recent sales in the area, we look at all this. And when you know that you're about anywhere between, you know, 600,000 to 800,000 being underquoted, and you see the participation on the day, it just makes you want to cry, you know, given the fact that how so-called reputable agents bring the industry to shame because of the shenanigans, basically underquoting. So Parapower tweeted out what he found, what the Ray Group put out. And again, this is, you know, I'm not trying to be mean to any agency out there or defame anybody. This is, you know, public domain. Just reading out what they put out. And they write, there was a lot of action, auction action this weekend, and buyers were not deterred by rising interest rates. An auction in Sydney's North Shore reported a whopping 19 registered bidders. I mean, I just asked the question. Was this the auction that the 19 registered bidders attended? Yeah, because if he was, you know, I think the head office better pull that agent in and give him a sweep, you know, give him a couple of slaps, because it sold at the end of the day, it sold for over 2.5 million. But it should never have been guided that low. Even the hedonic, which I often criticise, was giving you an indicative value of that property at $3 million. Albeit it's generally indicative. But as I said, just the value of the land alone was 1.6 in my view, if you were going to knock the house out and build something new on it.
So the other quoting story is you start with a very low price, then you can celebrate that you've gone way over. But actually, if you look at the fundamentals, they just started too low, right? And that's a technique that we've discussed many times, particularly now. And we're going to see more of it, I'm sure.
There was a TV crew there as well, Martin. I don't know what
the convenient, huh?
Yeah, it was because anyway. And this is the where our viewers. I'm sure our viewers are very careful, and those new to the show. These are the warnings that we put out there. Just be careful. Just do your due diligence before you attend.
I'm sorry. Get your own independent view of the value. Don't be just be persuaded by what the agent may say. Now, let's just quickly talk about the numbers, because surprise, surprise, they are still going up.
Yeah, look, they are. There's three screenshots that I've sent you again from the beginning of the month to now. And I take them around the same time of the day, keeping in mind that the first two thirds of the day is taken up by agents taking the listing numbers off market that got sold over the weekend. And then when I see when I'm looking at the domain numbers, I'll see on the Mondays, I see the dropping, and then when I see them picking back up again, it gives me an idea. So it's roughly around 3-4 o'clock that they start, that these screenshots are from. And yeah, so these are the starts for each of the last 3 weeks, and this week is no different. They're higher than the previous two. And again, we should be retreating because seasonal conditions, the winter generally retreat, but we're not. We're still moving ahead. Even the for sale by underquoting or by auction, they're still strong. They're still close to 1,000 in Sydney, just over or close to 900.
And Tarek reported the auction clearances, which were relatively down again, right? Particularly in Sydney, Melbourne slightly higher than last week. But still pretty weak numbers. And I guess the point here is that there's more choice. Prices are a bit more rubbery in some cases. But I did notice in your numbers it was the apartments which was moving up higher and stronger than houses, which is consistent with what we've seen for the last few months.
Definitely. And again, from we've been saying this from when the spruikers, the spruiking companies and marketing companies and real estate agencies that deal in that space, when they were choking or restricting the number of apartments on market. I think what we're seeing now is the amount of apartments that are coming on market is because they can't hold them back that long. The vendors, that whether they're overseas, they can only suffer for so long. They can only bleed or hemorrhage for so long before they have to sell. So I think what we're seeing, the numbers on market for apartments and also for homes in these times, and the ones that are coming on, they're definitely not there to test the market. They're there because they want to sell, they need to sell, or they have to sell. I can see the apartment numbers climb to 14,000 the way we're going by the time spring comes along.
Well, of course, the solution is to change the visa scheme to get more people coming from overseas to buy some of these properties. And guess what? There's an article which suggests that's pretty much what they're going to do.
I wonder who said that. I wonder who's been speaking about that for the last 3 or 4 months.
I wonder, could it be a Monday evening property show?
Something like that. Yeah, look, it's there. And we're smooching, it's a smooch either way from China to Australia and Australia to China, I guess. So it's got to happen. It's going to happen. And, skilled. And this particular article talks about the skilled migrants, and the skilled migrants are not necessarily just coming over from China. They're going to be coming out from the rest of the world as well, English is a strong language, if not the main language in those countries as well. Mm. But yeah, so we're gonna get it from two fronts. There's no look, as much as we'd hate to say it, Martin, but what other alternative do they have? Given the fact that there's such shortages in the workforce. Yep. We know that Penny Wong is over in the Pacific Islands, but look without being disrespectful, the Pacific Islanders don't make up the nature of the workers that we need in the low-paying income workers that we need in the sectors that are in demand in the city areas. Generally, the Pacific Islanders go out into the regional areas to work there, and if they do work in the construction industry, they're mainly doing the heavy lifting stuff, scaffolding or the like. But there's a lot of other groups of people that are best suited to the Asian communities small, medium-sized, and large businesses need here in order to stay afloat. Otherwise, they're going to go backwards and they're going to shut down.
Absolutely. Well, I'll remind our viewers that a few weeks ago we were talking about the levers that they might pull, and we suggested they might do the migration lever and they might do the incentives lever. Well, we've seen both of those. Okay, so the next one off on the table will be some sort of tweak from the banks to extend the life of an average loan or to make it cheaper in some other way, right? So watch this space for that one. I'm sure it'll be coming quite soon.
Definitely. Like you and I said, it's going to be, you can will your mortgage. You no longer, you know.
50-year mortgage is what you want. I tell you what, I mean, you know, it's in Japan. It'll be the intergenerational mortgage. So rather than actually leaving your assets or just leave your liabilities for your estate to solve it. And, you know, it's interesting in my surveys, I am getting a little bit of, yeah, I'm always going to have debt. I'm going to go to the grave with a debt that somebody has to sort it out. So we'll see whether that sticks. Well, but
here's one for you before we go. If the governments, both state and federal governments, start saying how successful this joint venture scheme is, I could almost see it that you're going to get private enterprises coming in with the same schemes, and it's going to be blessed by the state and federal government. You've got Built to Rent, obviously, but I can almost smell or see that as the future. But the private sector will more than likely, just if they do come in with these joint venture schemes, that they'll come in and they'll probably just participate in home dwellings. And if they are going to go into apartments, it's going to be very, very exclusive ones.
Absolutely. Yeah, it'll be the top end of the market. Right, before we go, another tip of the week, and this is a very relevant power-related one, isn't it, Edwin?
Oh, look, it is very relevant, and it's, again, something that I'm doing myself, and it's really, I felt because of the warnings that we've been getting, because of the shortages, the power outages, and everything else that are looming, and all the talk about energy, power, and energy. Look, I'm getting obviously rewired the house and the studios and everything, but we're also going to get hardwired. Going to get small generators hardwired to the homes, and this is something that I guess our viewers should be looking at. Solar isn't enough, especially if we're going to get these long stints of rain and cloudy days and so forth. That's just not going to be enough. Small generator that could sustain 3-4 main appliances. The worst case scenario is, you know, you because we don't know. I mean, we're in winter, so we're not sort of thinking about, you know, if we get a power outage and we're out for over 8 hours or 12 hours, you know, our fridges aren't going to be, you know, the food in fridges and freezers aren't going to be affected as much because of the cold weather. But I'm sort of thinking more in summer month, you know, what's going to happen. So I'm thinking, you know, here's a thought, just get something, get a small generator hardwired or prepare your circuit boards to take on a small generator that can give you power for 4 or 5 hours. And that doesn't need to be big, just very portable small generator, outdoor generator. And but the important thing is to have your to upgrade your switchboards in order to make sure nothing goes bad with when you introduce this sort of generators into the circuitry.
Yeah, and get a qualified professional to do it, because it's illegal to do it if you're not a qualified electrician. So just to be clear, you aren't doing it yourself, are you?
No, this is so until I get mine, mate, and until, you know, trying to keep I still gotta
exactly. Yeah, you go with a local flame instead. Edwin, a very important show tonight. Thank you very much for your time once again. Always good to catch up and to see what's going on. And every week it's just amazing how quickly things are moving on. So we'll look forward to doing it all again next week.
Definitely, Martin. Thank you very much.
Okay. Keep warm. Take care.
Thank you.